Brian Danielson.
Speaking of, you told me this was pretty, I didn't even look into this yet.
Yeah, so I haven't gone through the actual audio, but I was going to read off some of the transcript and then kind of apply it. And obviously people can make up their own minds about this as well. But he was on One Fall with Ron Fuchs and Funches. Sorry, I keep fucking up that guy's name.
Yeah.
And he was talking about the envisioning of his last wrestling match. And it was weird that first off, they even brought this up, or actually I should say, Daniel Bryan kind of brought this up, or Bryan Danielson brought this up. Sorry. And he was quoted as saying, "I would like to wrestle until I would like to wrestle a match 2 weeks before I die." And to not know that it's my last match, that would be my ideal situation. I'm not going to be a full-time wrestler for much longer. Laughs. All that said, I'm not going to be a full-time wrestler much longer. When my AEW contract is up, that's pretty much me being done as a full-time wrestler. I like the way people like Terry Funk and Jerry Lawler do it, where they do it for fun. They don't do it all the time. They do it here and there, that sort of thing. As long as they have fun doing it, and I experience joy doing it, it's something I want to continue doing for the rest of my life. You know, one of the things that was brought to my attention was when I was forced to retire, is that you never know when your last match is going to be. The last match I had before I was forced to retire, I didn't know that I was going to, that it was going to be my last match. And then it was, And I didn't know until 2 months later when they were like, "I don't think we're going to let you come back." And then it turned out to not be my last match. I went years thinking it was my last match and then it wasn't. It's interesting to me. And I kind of brought this up in the chat earlier. It's not the same guy who first came into AEW. This doesn't sound like the same guy that came into AEW. When Daniel Bryan came into WWE or into AEW, he had the thank you WWE speech, which was very heartfelt. It's very hopeful. I remember me and you, and I think pretty much everybody praising the shit out of what a class act Bryan Danielson was.
Yeah.
And how he carried himself. And it was like, look, it's not a fuck WWE. I'm coming over to AEW. Even though AEW was really trying to push that narrative at the time, he didn't give a fuck about what they wanted to push as a narrative. He genuinely loved his time there. He loved a lot of the people that work there. And he owed all of his success, at least in his opinion, or the way that he stated it, because of his time in WWE, which is not arguable. And you hear that. You hear that hope of him wanting to be the guy to come into AEW and have great new matches, work new styles, work with these younger kids and teach them things and maybe even go to Japan, which is one of the things he wanted to do. And now he's doing random interviews where he's talking about what he wants to do is wrestle a match a couple weeks before he dies. And the only reason that this matters, like if I was talking about anybody else, this would be me stretching the situation. The problem is Daniel Bryan is also the guy who had a public fucking mental breakdown. He's also the guy who we saw even on the fucking Total Bella shows weeping like a fucking just to the core in a yurt with some fucking shaman, you know, talking
banged
about how
up on mushrooms or banged up on whatever the fuck. Yeah.
Right. Like, this is clearly a guy who probably deals with depression. Not even probably. This is a guy who deals with depression. And when you think of the way that AEW has been lately, with all the negativity in the back, all the scrums and the fucking bickering and the, you should work here, you don't belong here, all like all this stuff, I can't imagine that this is a great environment for a guy like Bryan Danielson.
No, no. And by the way, I'm glad that you went that direction, because I was going to say, you want to order the light roast or the dark roast? I got to kind of go with the dark roast here, which is that this guy has not lived a minute of his life since he was, what, 17, 18 years old, that wasn't consumed by the idea of the wrestling business. He has now walked into an environment. And by the way, please don't take this as me just being like, you're looking for another way to... No, dude, really think. Use your fucking brain for 5 seconds.
Daniel Bryan is one of your favorite wrestlers of all time. You've said it multiple times. You're not going to shit.
I love Daniel Bryan. So it's got nothing to do with him in this respect. It's got everything to do with the environment, like you said, that he's in. If this is the only thing this guy has ever cared about, and he really has this idea of what the industry is and what the business is and the direction it's supposed to go in, and he has this deep love for it. Imagine him walking into that place. Imagine him going in there and being like, okay, here are the two things that you have right now. You have WWE, which, you know, for all of its flaws, at least is like something resembling the fucking wrestling business to some degree, I guess. Or the alternative is this rich kid running a fucking playground with nothing but just fucking favoritism and friend time and toxicity and angry fans and just bullshit nonstop. And here I am, a guy coming into this company that a half dozen years ago, give or take, I'm putting this on a weird scale now because of COVID, my whole year thing is even more fucked up. But, you know, he was the biggest star in the entire wrestling industry.
Oh, yeah.
Then that went away because he got hurt, right?
Right.
I mean, that's really, he cooled off fast, but he was the biggest thing going. And then he got told he couldn't wrestle and he was gone, right? So he comes back. And he's like, all right, ready to roll. Let's fucking do this. And it's not the same because WWE has changed and it's moved on and the fans are a little bit hot and cold. Or,
yeah.
You know, so then he finds himself into this new company, let's say. All right. He ends up in this new place and he's like, all right, fresh start.
Right. No, that's it. I mean, even Oki's saying, I never understood why he went to AEW. Fresh start. Nailed it.
Yep.
Right.
Yeah, fresh start. You know, I mean, you got to think of it. This is no different. His level of depression that he's feeling right now, I'm sure, is no different than the way a guy like Tom Brady feels right now. The way a dude like, you know, Ben Raplesberger fucking feels probably right now. The way Peyton felt when he retired. All these guys that were superstars, that their whole life was sitting there and it was about throwing a fucking ball X amount of weeks a year and that was it. And now they got to think of their life in a different way. And all of the guys that I just mentioned, for the most part, at least got to live there. They get to go a little bit out on top. Is Brian going out on top?
No.
No, he got a fresh start.
He barely feels like he's a shadow of himself in this company. Yeah. And I really think that when he came in there, not just a fresh start, but I really believe because it was a young promoter, a new promoter with the amount of money to not only, you know, carry his career and keep him and his family well fed, which is probably his number one concern, but his second concern being wrestling and being able to partake that knowledge and spread it around to a lot of the younger talents, which is also something that AEW was boasting at the time, was like, look,
supposedly was going to be. Yeah.
Right. So it's like, you're giving him none of the Vince McMahon bullshit, and you're in a brand new environment with everybody learning how this goes, with a bunch of veterans that know how this should work. What could possibly go wrong?
Well, the answer is pretty much fucking everything. And now we're looking at it, you know, well over a year now, Bryan Danielson has been there, right? And in this time, he's seen the industry become what from this end? A big cry.
It's flipped. It's kind of flipped. It's really weird. Yep. Vince McMahon is gone and everybody's praising WWE. At least the wrestlers are talking about how happy they are. I know Ripley did the other day. I think Rey Mysterio had some positive things to say about the way that the locker room and everybody feels. Like, ever since Stephanie and H and Nick Khan took control, things seem to be going better. People are getting listened to. Ideas are being tried. And AEW is now suffering a lot of this public scrutiny, not only just based on the scrum, but on social media experiences, how the gates are, how the actual fans are, the toxicity. And it's really fucking weird because it's almost like Brian brought the cloud with him.
I know. He came over here and you're thinking to yourself, good God almighty, This company has CM Punk. They have Daniel Bryan. They got these guys that are like, what could go wrong? Everything. Yeah. That's what went wrong. Everything. Daniel Bryan is a fucking footnote in this company. Yeah. Figure that out for me. Figure out how that guy is such a non-contributing factor to your show.
I love Mox. I think Mox, I enjoy Mox. I know he has some really bad characteristics too, but overall, I really do enjoy Mox. There is no reason that Bryan Danielson shouldn't be more talked about than Moxley.
No, this is like comparing George the Animal Steel to fucking Bret Hart.
Mm-hmm.
Honest to God. And by the way, Bret Hart with more personality. Oh, goodness, don't get mad at me. It's the guy is fucking great.
Yeah.
He's so talented, and he's completely wasted on the show. Completely and utterly wasted. And that's once again saying, I don't think that if for whatever reason the world just, you know, everything just came into place and Daniel Bryan was, you know, back in WWE in 2 months, that he would be the guy at the top of the card.
Yeah.
But at least there would be a feeling that if he wanted to go, he would go with dignity.
Yeah.
There would be this feeling that he would get a big WrestleMania send-off. He would have a moment in front of 70,000 people and they'd cheer for him and they'd thank him, and it would come from an honest to goodness place.
Don't you think that the value of working a program with Bryan Danielson would actually mean more to the younger talent than Moxley? Like, and I hate to say it like this, but
shouldn't that be obvious? But it's not.
God, that's what sucks. I would think so. Like MJF versus Bryan Danielson would have seemed like a better feud choice than MJF versus Mox.
Absolutely.
And but when they had Mox and Eddie, it's like, okay, there's an idea, because they're similar in a lot of ways. MJF is a better talker than Bryan Danielson, but Bryan Danielson gets the people just as much as MJF does. And as far as in-ring stuff, what the fuck couldn't MJF learn from Bryan Danielson?
Yeah, there's not much he couldn't. This is what kills me. Like I said, like watching this from an outside perspective, I could totally see why this fucking guy is losing. And by the way, this is me just pie in the
speculating.
Sky.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, he, for all we know, he could have just had a shitty day. How many times have you been caught on a shitty day?
Of course.
Someone here, you say some shit and they're like, wow, that guy's pretty miserable dude. And you're like, actually, I'm really not. I was just in a bad mood that day. But ultimately you go, well, if this dude is really fucking bumming, he hasn't been given much reason to get out of that.
Right. Right.
There's really not much for him to kind of knock that fucking dark cloud from over his head, because still, even with Punk gone, Punk left and we were like, oh shit. Nobody was like, you know, why isn't Daniel Bryan and Bryan Danielson involved in this? This doesn't make, what's he doing? Oh, he's in a 4-way match for a title that doesn't exist anymore.
Right.
Catching Sammy Guevara on his Shooting Star Presses to the outside. This is what you want to do with one of the best fucking performers in pro wrestling history? This is what you have for him? I mean, give me a fucking break. In his waning years?
Right.
I could completely see why this guy, after, what, decades of this being the most important part of his life outside, I'm sure, of his wife and kids, he looks at this industry and goes, I don't see this going anywhere good.
No. No, and it's sad, because he's just another one of those guys that just seems to be filling up the roster as opposed to the iconic wrestler and character that people fell in love with. I feel like that even with Regal. Regal was like this iconic character, and he just feels like he's on the back burner, even though he was just involved with the MJF stuff. It seems like there's a lot of that, almost as if these guys who should be the ones that are focal in AEW, that are going to be the ones that really carry the new brand or the new talent of the next generation, are kind of just shuffled along because they have to make room for, I don't know, everybody's goons. Everybody that comes out with fucking goons.
Everybody's goons and everybody's fucking biffles. That's
right. Right. And it's like, man, can we get rid of some of these goons and focus a little bit more time on these talents that people actually know and love? I think that these shows would be a lot more filled up if there was more programs dedicated to people that have already established themselves a little bit. And I'm not sitting there saying, well, you know, we don't all want to see ex-WWE guys. That's not my point. My point is, why not take these ex-WWE guys that they clearly have that are wrestling icons and make them more of a focal point on the show? Why does everything have to be evenly split? Not everybody deserves equal TV time. I'm sorry. I don't agree with that.
No, that's the insanity of it, too. Like, oh, no, make sure everybody gets on the show that's good. That's not, you know, no. Put the people on the show that are going to make the show better.
Right.